Funkertown in my city, Fort Worth. Plan on some big things coming. Big things coming. I got a media company that's going to probably get off the ground soon. It's going to involve a lot of key players. It's going to be full of variety. A lot different than what you're seeing on social media right now. I even have a good friend here by the name of Jay. I'll just leave it at that. But me and Jay got some big things working. But as I explained to him, you know, I needed an opportunity to kind of get my feet wet. You know, I'm no stranger to being in front of a camera or talking. But the social media space is a different space. And so I just wanted to make sure that, you know, I can get on here and make sure we provide a quality product. And so you'll be hearing about things over the next couple of months. MOBO-Media is going to be one of the main platforms to be put out, which is going to be separate from what Jay and I are going to be doing. So just look, you know, to be honest with you, just look forward to some surreal, truthful, honest commentary about current events, good and bad, things that have happened in the past, things that we can anticipate in the future. Speaking of past, there's a story that that has plagued me or has bothered me for the last couple of days. And it actually took me into a deep depression. And I'll tell this story, but I will say it's something that I've never shared publicly. And it's been a long forgotten story. So November 16th, 1984, I recall riding around with my mother right before Thanksgiving. And yeah, I recall it was raining outside and it was cold. Real nasty weather, Texas weather back then. And as we were riding in the car, a newsflash came over. And what had happened was a 15-year-old young man was killed by Fort Worth police officers, by two Fort Worth police officers. The thing that struck me was the name that they spoke when they broadcast this news. His name was David Jefferson. I can't tell you how shocked I was when I heard this. For one, he's 15. Two, it changed my whole understanding of policing, community policing, because up until that point, the only bad interaction I ever had with a cop, and I don't even consider it a bad interaction. You know, when I was younger, my parents bought me a BB gun. I used to, you know, that was a thing back in the day, little BB guns, you know, shoot cans and bottles and things like that. But I always, of course, stretched the line. I would go and shoot at birds and, you know, just about anything out there. And so for your environmentalists, I'm sorry, but I was young and dumb. But I would shoot birds and became a good shot, you know, became a good shot. Well, one day when I was walking down the street, I was walking down the street carrying a BB gun rifle, and a Fort Worth police officer pulled up beside me. And I didn't see him coming because he kind of came up pretty quiet and just came right up beside me. And he says, so what are you doing out here? I said, well, I'm just out here playing, man. You know what I'm saying? Shoot BB gun. He says, so you're not out here shooting windows or anything like that? Or shooting at people's cars and things like that? I said, nah, man. Nah, you know. But I didn't tell him I was shooting birds. You know, I just told him I was looking for places to shoot good targets, shoot things. And so he told me that was not a good idea to be walking around the neighborhood like that with that gun. Keep in mind, this was before some of the more recent incidents involving children with guns, with grown ass law enforcement pulling up on them, kids with toy guns. Well, long story short, the officer told me to just, you know, if I'm a kid to BB gun like that, just stay in the backyard, shoot at bottles, shoot at cans, but just kind of stay off the streets with it. And I think at the time, it was a subtle way of him saying, you know, you don't want anyone to confuse that with a real gun. So I really appreciate it. You know, he was a very kind officer, real nice, cool. He said, man, you have a nice day. Just be safe out here. Okay, I said, all right, you know. Fast forward to November 16, 1984, broadcast of the radio station. 15-year-old young man, David Jefferson, shot and killed by police officers. Not only shot and killed, but shot six times by police officers. And the story went something like this. So I have a large family in Fort Worth. And if you ask me what part of Fort Worth I'm from, I'm just going to tell you I'm from Fort Worth. It's just my family's just that large there. Well, on the south side of Fort Worth, or near the south side, I believe, there's an intersection called Rosedale and Riverside. And Rosedale and Riverside actually has a long history, you know. It's a lot of local fame there, you know. You have one of the only black ice cream parlors I know and that serve very good ice cream cones called JW Cream. And at the corner of Riverside and Berry, they also had, you know, obviously some of the negative stuff going on. You know, should have maybe been prostitutes or drugs, you know, whatever. You know, it's any other city, what have you. But that wasn't the thing that stood out. The thing that stood out was the way the community came together, took care of each other. That's just the way it was back then. Well, what happened was these two officers pulled up on a scene. They pulled up and they had already been kind of canvassing the area looking for anything that looked suspicious, which to me is over-policing. Whole nother subject. Why the hell are you in black communities looking for things to put black people in jail for? Another subject. Anyway, they apparently say they spotted some folks across the street near the corner of Riverside and Rosedale at the intersection. They say they thought they saw some drug interaction. Basically, they just saw some people standing around, you know, talking. Who else knows what they were looking at? But they decided to go over and approach these folks. Okay. One of these folks was David Jefferson. And when they approached the folks, they were all standing there, you know, the two officers, three or four folks. And eventually, some of the folks started walking off. They began to walk off from the cops, you know. But David stood there. He stood there to have a conversation with them. And for some reason, a scuffle jumped off. A scuffle started. And to this day, I myself can't even speak to why this scuffle occurred. The only thing I can think, based on other parts of the story, was they were trying to handcuff him. And he probably was saying, well, hold on, wait a minute. What did I do? What did I do, you know? And when they handcuffed him, I'm assuming they handcuffed him, okay? And we'll get to that later. But when they began scuffling, the officers were not close to each other. One of the officers was at a distance. I don't know if he, I think he began to follow the people that walked off or something like that. But long story short, David, somehow, they both fell. And somehow, David just ended up on top of the officer. It wasn't an aggressive thing, I don't believe. Just knowing David, he fell on top of the officer. And the damn officer yells out, he's grabbing my gun, he's grabbing my gun. So the officer that was chasing the young man that walked away turns around, walks toward David and the other officer on the ground and fires three shots and shoots David. Okay. Shoots him. Three of those shots were in the back, by the way. So David stood up for the cop to have to shoot him. Okay. He gained his ground and got up, and that's when the officer shot him. After hearing this other cop saying, he grabbed my gun. After the officer shot David three times, which I believe is three times, I have to go back and read the story. After he shot him three times, he falls to the ground. The officer that David was on top of gets up, grabs his revolver, goes and shoots him 3 more times while he's laying on the ground. If that's not a fucking execution, I don't know what is. Again, up until that time, my thoughts of policing in our communities were, you know, I thought that they were doing okay, you know. They would come when you called them, you know. But at the same time, I was a child. And so I'm sure folks above me, or older than me, had different experiences, worse experiences. The officers went on to, when they shot David, they handcuffed him, apparently. That's what came out of the report, handcuffing. Some bystanders are saying that he was handcuffed when they shot him. He was already handcuffed when they shot him. He just happened to fall on top of the officer. Okay. He fell on top of the officer when he was handcuffed. And that's when he screamed, "He's got my gun." That's been debated. It was debated during the run up to the grand jury proceedings and hearings. I doubt all of it. Particularly when they came out and said there was a matchbox found nearby with some small amounts of heroin inside the matchbox. When I heard this, I was disgusted. I was disgusted because I knew it had to be planted. I knew it had to be planted. I knew it had to be planted. I knew David was not the aggressor. I know they made this story up. I know there were some cocky cops, at least one of them, because one of them was reported to have been harassing folks previously, so he had a history of it. Oh, and by the way, these cops, the one that had been harassing folks, had only been on the force 2 years. The other cop, 10 months in training. Go figure. So they say they found the small amount of heroin in the matchbox near David. This infuriated his family. It infuriated those that witnessed that execution. It infuriated those that knew him. That's not what he was into. He was not a drug kid. You wouldn't find, just like his uncle said in an article back then, you won't find a track mark on his arm. He don't shoot dope. He don't do dope. That's not his thing. The reason I'm bringing this story up to you, it's because David was my friend. He was my friend. He and I graduated middle school together. We went to elementary school together. He would visit my home. He was a type of a kid that would, you know, you see him all around Fort Worth. He was just everybody's friend. He just had just such a positive energy about him. I mean, very positive energy about him. Whatever you were doing, whether we were shooting marbles back then or doing things like crayfishing, what we call it crawfishing, take a little piece of bacon on a string next to railroad tracks and try to get those little critters out of those holes. And all we do is take them and have them fight each other and put them in buckets and water and things like that. But David would come up on us doing those type things and join in. And we have some just great conversations, you know, about a lot of things. But he was just a great kid. He was a great kid. And so, as you can imagine, him being killed at the age of 15, me being 15 years old, and that being a sort of a redirect of my thinking of policing in black communities, it was quite traumatic. And I've held on to that for 38 years. For 38 years, I've held on to that. There's something deep down in me. It's telling me not to let this go, because if you read all of the evidence related to that situation, it bleeds foul. It screams foul. And oh, by the way, they did hire a special monitor of the proceedings. Apparently, there was a recommendation for the city to pay $10,000 for a special monitor to monitor the process, to make sure it was fair and just as it relates to the grand jury proceedings. The city refused to pay $10,000 and only offered to pay $5,000. And the person selected to do the monitoring was former prosecutor by the name of Royce West. Royce West is a well-known figure in the Dallas community. Nothing bad said about Mr. West. But I do question some of the things I've read in some of the, you know, the articles, particularly with Mr. West agreeing that everything, you know, when it went, you know, everything was good. There was no foul play as far as the process, but he took issue with the police department's propensity to only go by their officer's account of what happened. For some reason, they kept going by only what their officers, you know, perceived, and discounting what the community saw. That in itself bleeds foul play. Serious foul play. So, you know, this is the first time sharing anything like that. I'm relieved to be able to just speak on it. You know, and I hope anybody that knew David can remember David, remember that situation. I asked you to go back and look at that evidence. I asked you to go back and look at that case. I asked you to go back and look at the circumstances. I asked you to go back and look at the man, the boy, David Jefferson, and who he was. Read the articles. Everybody had nothing to say about him. You'd hear people say, no, not Dave. Not him, not him, not him. No, that's not the type of kid that's killed by police. You know. But Philando Castile was not the type of man to be killed by police either. So with that, I'll end this. Thank you for listening. And please never forget the name David Jefferson. Killed November 16, 1984. Near the corner of Riverside and Rosedale. Take care.